we're studying kingdom man. And I like what the front says. Every man's destiny, every woman's dream. That's what I'm doing, ladies. I'm making three men down there. Goodness, you didn't know it. That's what I'm working on there. I don't think my book says that. To look at that, I saw that in those. And I thought, yep, making some dream men. What woman would dream of making a nightmare is what it looks like. So, guys, if you are a part of that Bible study, if you're not part of that Bible study and would like to be, come by and pick up a book and come Tuesday morning at 6:30. I will be there. Me and Roger both will be there Tuesday morning. I know the convention is going on, but it's in Russellville. We'll be driving back and forth. So, we will be there at 6:30, 6:35, something like that. We'll be there. We will be there. Brother Leon had some information about some prayer time, and we'll share it with you before church tonight, and I just ask him if you would mind to come and just to share with you about his mission trip.
It's very difficult to follow every woman's dream. just a word of personal testimony first, if I may. I grew up in church. My very first memories are in church. But most of my life, I've been part of God's frozen chosen. Put money in the offering plate for missions, an extra buck in for Lottie, and basically said, "Here I am, Lord, send them." But as God can do, He convicted me and Brenda a few years ago. The pastor of the church that we ran at that time announced to us, the congregation, that the church is going to be involved in a mission effort in a black third world country. I thought I had left Arkansas. But soon discovered that was not the case. And we've been involved in mission work with the Fula Kunda people group in Senegal for the past few years. This will be my eighth trip. Brenda's been on four. This particular trip is very different. Typically it's been evangelism, working in the villages with some of the very poorest people on God's earth, very humbly. But this time, as of January of this year, the Senegalese people have begun a church planting effort. They started a 6-month school for church planters in January, graduated the first 17 church planters. And these are all Africans, African-led, not Americans. It's African evangelizing their people and organizing the house churches. So they graduated 17 people in June, and they held another 3-month church planting school that just finished this past month in October. It was primarily for young Christians, students, and that was their break. There'll be another church planting school that will start the last of this month. But what they have asked for is help in how to organize, how to support the church planters. And by God's grace and His will, this is expanded way beyond Senegal. In this training, there will be approximately 30 church planting leaders from a number of countries, not just Senegal, but also Mauritania, Guinea-Bissau, Guinea. I'm not sure about Ghana, but Ghana may have some representation there also. But nonetheless, these will be 30 folks that are God's people in those countries. They need help with how to get structured for the house churches. Obviously, there are some serious challenges with language. I have no idea, honestly, in teaching these folks from multiple countries and multiple languages, how redneck English is going to translate to them. But, there will be, that's in God's hands, okay? I'm asking for a sign-up. I'll be happy to be in the back of the church after service. A sign-up sheet here, 24-hour prayer sheet. So if you feel so led to do so, it's through His will, His work, His prayer, His people. So if he is to be spiritually successful in that country, It's going to be, got to be supported by the prayer of his people. So if you would do that, I'd appreciate that. There is a sheet here that shows what the specific prayer needs are and an itinerary for each day, so you'll know what to pray for during those times. So if you do that, would be much appreciated. Thank you, sir.
Very good.
Thank you, Brother Leon. And please do catch him after service. I think he's going to be back in the foyer as you leave. And sign up to pray for those 24 hours each day. Lord God's here. There. All right. Do we have a video tonight? No? No? Christy's smiling and shaking her head, and then she's kind of rolling her eyes. So I don't know what happened to the video. We were going to show a video for the call ministry, but that is not here. And so maybe we can do that another time. But please do remember the call ministry. Remember what they do in our county and across our state. I think it was 55. Is that right, Christy? 55 churches that are involved.
Yes. In Claiborne County.
In our county, isn't that right?
Yeah.
So there are several churches of many different denominations that are involved in that. Of course, we've got Bill and Christy in our church. Those prayer cards, I did not mention this at the end of service, but those prayer cards are here. That's a different family. There's a different family in this state.
Okay.
There's one different card, so we'll put Bill and Christy over top of them. Pick up a prayer card if you did not pick one up this morning and take it home, put it on your refrigerator, put it wherever you will see it every day to remember to pray for Bill and Christy and also Josh and Mike. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer to start. Father, we love you, we praise you, we thank you so much for this night. Father, I lift up Brother Leon to you, who will be going, leaves next Sunday to go and do something that I know is very near and dear to your heart, to be on mission for you in Africa. And so, Father, I pray that you be with him as he stands to teach in Senegal. And, Father, I pray that you would use him mightily in that place, use the message mightily in that place so that many souls could be saved. Father, as he said, it's not about us, it's not about him, it's about you, and it's about your honor and your glory. And so, Father, I pray that you would use him for your honor and for your glory in Senegal. Father, we do lift up Bill and Christy to you and continue to pray for them and Josh and Malachi. And Father, we pray that you would use them to make a difference in these young men's lives. And Father, that because of their stay here, that these young men would have a different life. And Father, I pray that they would see and know your love and care for them. Father, I love you. I praise you. I thank you so much for this night. Thank you for an opportunity once again to meet, to worship you. And Father, we pray that you would help us to do that in both spirit and in truth. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, great talk. Can't see the words. Let's stand together as a sing. Come, people of the risen King.
People of the risen King, who delight to bring him praise. Come on, tune your hearts to sing to the morning star of grace. From the shifting shadows of the earth, we will lift our eyes to him. Where steady arms of mercy reach to gather children in. Rejoice, rejoice, let every tongue rejoice. One heart, one voice, O Church of Christ, rejoice.
Come let us adore. Father, we are thankful today, dear Lord, that we are gathered together, Lord, to worship a God who is worthy of our worship. We are gathered today, Lord, in the name of a glorious Savior, Jesus Christ. Father, I thank you, Lord, for the wonderful cross. Lord, I pray that you would remind us once again, dear Lord, of just how significant that is in each of our lives, Father, and how much we still need you today, Lord, just as much as we ever have. Lord, I pray that you would speak through your word tonight in Jesus' name.
Got your Bible, make your way to Hebrews chapter 6. Get a big look at Hebrews on Sunday nights and getting back on our normal track of Judges in the morning and Hebrews on a Sunday night. Somebody told me this morning that I preached a great message, but I preached the flowers to wilt. The flowers up front had wilted. And Ken, I'm not going to tell them who it was, but Ken said they were beautiful when we came in, and when we got through, they had wilted. And then he said, but that was a great message. I said, yeah, I can tell. Man, tell you what, with friends like that, you need dinner. Hebrews chapter 6. Hebrews chapter 6, we're going to begin in verse 13. Will you stand with me on the reading of God's word? We don't always do this on Sunday nights, but stand with me as we read these few verses out of chapter 6. The Bible says there in verse 13, it says, for when God made a promise to Abraham, since he had no one greater to swear by, he swore by himself. Amen. 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 How can you read those words without saying a good amen? He had no one else to swear by that was greater, so he just swore by himself. I will indeed bless you, I will greatly multiply you. And so, after waiting patiently, Abraham obtained the promise. For men swear by something greater than themselves, and for them a confirming oath ends every dispute. Because God wanted to show his unchangeable purpose even more clearly to the heirs of the promise, he guaranteed it with an oath, so that through two unchangeable things in which it is impossible for God to lie, we who have fled for refuge might have strong encouragement to seize the hope set before us. We have this hope as an anchor for our lives, safe and secure. It enters the inner sanctuary behind the curtain. Well, these are some rich words, y'all. Jesus has entered, in verse 20, there on our behalf as a forerunner, because he has become a high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Father, thank you for the truth that found in these rich verses. Father, help us as we study them tonight to get the truth and apply it to everyday life. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Point number one of a three-point message that we might get through. I would hate to wilt the flowers tonight. Wilt the flowers. Somebody told me that that one of the pastors in town, he started offering, because he preaches so long, he started offering popcorn and drink when he preaches, and said, if you keep preaching the way you did this morning, you're going to have to offer a three-course meal. that hurts, y'all. That really hurts. I hear we're having pastor appreciation next week. I can't wait for that. I can't wait to read some of those cards. Jerry said, put whatever you want to on them. Good night. All right. Point number one. Abraham was blessed by the grace of God. Blessed by the grace of God. Abraham obtained favor with God. But he obtained favor with God not by his works, but by his belief in a righteous, holy, and grace-filled God. You find that there. He says, for when God made a promise to Abraham, since he had no one greater to swear by, he swore by himself. It gives the idea of God looked all over and said, well, I can't find anything greater than me to swear by, so I'll just swear by myself. And he swore, I will bless you and will greatly multiply you. And then the Bible says, so waiting patiently, Abraham obtained the promise. How did he obtain the promise of God? By his obedience? Yes, by his obedience. But by his belief and trust in a holy God who would grace him with the gift of his presence. That's it. That's it. How has anyone ever been born again? How has anyone ever had a relationship with God? By the grace of God. By the grace of God. By the grace of God, when Adam and Eve fell, God slaughtered an animal and placed skins upon their back. He shed precious blood of an animal so that their sins could be atoned for without the shedding of blood. This book that we're reading here in the book of Hebrews chapter 10 tells us without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. There's no remission. Your sins cannot be atoned for without the shedding of blood. Without the grace of God, you and I are destined for a devil's hell. For a devil's hell. But with the grace of God, you and I are destined for a place called heaven. And so Abraham received his blessing by the grace of God, made possible by the promise of God that he swore to an oath on his own name. Now, verse 14 is a direct quote of Genesis chapter 22. So I want to read to you the story where we find Abraham finding this blessing. Genesis 22, beginning in verse 1, the Bible says, after these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, here I am. He answered, take your son, he said, your only son Isaac, whom you love, go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains I will tell you about. Now listen, here's what we're reading. The only time in God's word that God says to offer a human sacrifice. Now we know, if you've been in church one day or two, you know the end of this story. He does not offer Isaac. He does not offer him as a burnt offering. But here he tells him to take him and offer him there as a burnt offering. So Abraham got up early in the morning in verse 3 and saddled his donkey and took with him two of his young men and his son Isaac. He split wood for the burnt offering and set out to go to the place that God had told him about. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. Then Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there to worship. Then we'll come back to you. Now, you've heard this before if you've been in church long, and most of you have. But whenever he tells those men that you stay here a while and we'll come back to we will come back from worshiping. And that means me and the boy, right? He doesn't talk about him and the donkey. It's him and the boy. And here's what Abraham believed. He had such a trust and he had such a belief in God. Not that God was not going to ask him to offer Isaac, but that God could raise his son Isaac even from the dead if he so chose to do that. Remember now, God's given Abraham a promise. God's given Abraham the promise that it's through Isaac that I will bless you and greatly multiply you and will give you a nation that you can't count. Like the sand on the seashores are uncountable, so will the people be that I will give you. And it's coming through Isaac. And so he has the promise of God in his pocket, knowing that God has asked him to go up and offer Isaac, but he believes in such a way that God would even raise him from the dead. Now, listen, that's a greater belief than God's going to provide a different way of sacrifice. Is it not? To believe that God would even raise his son from the dead. Well, that's a belief. Now, we say, well, yeah, but God raised Jesus from the dead, and so he's done that before, but he had not done that before here. So, anyway, moving on. He says in verse 6 of Genesis 22, Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac. In his hand, he took the fire and the sacrificial knife and the two of them, they walked together. Then Isaac spoke to his father Abraham and said, My father. And he replied, Here I am, my son. Isaac said, The fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? Verse 8, Abraham answered, God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son. Then the two of them walked on together. When they arrived at the place that God had told him about, Abraham built the altar there and arranged the wood. He bound his son Isaac and placed him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out and took his knife to slaughter his son, but the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. He replied, Here I am. Then he said, Do not lay a hand on the boy or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your only son from me. Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in the thicket by its horns. So Abraham went and took the ram and offered it as a burnt offering in the place of his son. And Abraham named that place, The Lord Will Provide. So today it is said, it will be provided on the Lord's mountain. Then the angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time from heaven and said, By myself I have sworn, this is the Lord's declaration, because you have done this thing and have not withheld your only son, I will indeed bless you and make your offspring as numerous as the stars of the sky and the sand on the seashore. Your offspring will possess the gates of their enemies. And all the nations of the earth will be blessed by your offspring, because you have obeyed my command. Abraham went back to his young men, and they got up and went together to Beersheba, and Abraham settled in Beersheba. Abraham walks up the mountain with his son and walks back down with his son by the very grace of God. Abraham is given a promise by God. By the very grace of God. And Abraham lived as a great leader of the Israelite nation. He is known as the father of the Israelites. He is the father of that nation, the beginning of that nation, simply by the grace of God. Did Abraham have to be obedient to God's will? Certainly he didn't. You see that there. This is where you see the grace of God and the works of man come in, and they don't, one doesn't work against the other, but they work hand in hand in unison. A man who has been gifted the grace of God from a holy God will walk in obedience to the grace of God. In other words, if you know Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, there ought to be a difference in your lifestyle. Amen?
Amen.
Your works ought to back up what you claim to know. Am I going to heaven because I preach? No, I preach because I'm guilty. You know that, and you know what that means to be walking in unison with the Spirit of God. I pray you do. If you don't, you ought to find out today. You ought to get to know Jesus tonight. And then as you leave, just begin to open up your heart with a bended knee and an open Bible to the will of God for your life and ask the Spirit to lead you, and I promise you, He will. He may take you to places like Senegal. He may take you like places like Ghana, and He may take you to places like Higdon to be a part of His kingdom. Brought you to a place called Westside to be part of His kingdom work. Thank you, son. Amen. Amen. Abraham was blessed by the grace of God. Now listen, the writer here of the book of Hebrews really likes Abraham. And remember, he's writing to Hebrew people, so it would make sense to like Abraham if you're writing to a Hebrew people. He mentions him some 10 times throughout this book. He mentions Abraham, he mentions Joshua, he mentions great leaders of the past. And he's already spent a couple of chapters in this book talking about Moses, and then moves on to Joshua. And so he's reminding them of their history to tell them of their future. And so he mentions Abraham, and he says that he got it by the promise of God. He says, men swear by something greater than themselves. And so God swore by something that was the only thing that could compare to Him, and it was Himself. Because God wanted, in verse 17, to show His unchangeable purpose even more clearly to the heirs to the promise, He guaranteed it with an oath. And so Abraham was blessed by the grace of God. And then point number two is all men can trust the Lord. Now verse 18 is a beautiful verse. A beautiful verse. He says that He guaranteed it with an oath in verse 17 so that through two unchangeable things in which it is impossible for God to lie. It's impossible for God to lie. In the book of Numbers 23 and verse 19, Balaam is singing a song, and here's what he says. He says, God is not a man who lies, or a son of man who changes his mind. Does he speak and not act, or promise and not fulfill? In other words, what he's saying there is that if God says it, that says it. If God's made the promise, he will fulfill the promise. Someone has said that you cannot break God's promises by leaning on them. I like that. You cannot break God's promises by leaning on them. Listen, if it weren't for the promises of God, if it weren't for the truth of God's word, I wouldn't be where I'm at today, and I've got an odd feeling that some of you would not be where you are today as well if it weren't for the promises of God. Listen, when the times get tough, the tough don't get going. Now, that, I don't believe that at all. The tough don't get going. I'm not a part of the tough. I'm a part of the weak. But when the times get tough, the promises start flowing. I'm reminded of the promises of God when my life gets tough. I'm reminded of what God has promised me in my own life of what He will do for me. And I want to remind you of just at least 12 promises that I jotted down here. One, God's presence. He'll never leave us nor forsake us. Hebrews 13:5 tells us that. God's protection, that He is our shield. Genesis 15 and verse 1 says that. His power. Isaiah 41 and verse 10 says, I will strengthen thee. And God's provision. Isaiah 41 and verse 10 also says, I will help thee. God's leading. The Bible says in John 10 and verse 14, and when He puts forth His own sheep, He goes before them. God's purpose. Number 6, I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil. Jeremiah 20 and verse 11. God's rest. Number 7, come unto me, all that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Matthew 11 and verse 28. God's cleansing. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's 1 John 1 and verse 9. God's goodness. No good thing has He withheld from them that work uprightly. Psalm 84 and verse 11. Number 10, God's faithfulness. The Lord will not forsake His people for His great namesake. 1 Samuel 12 and verse 22. God's guidance. The meek will He guide. Psalm 25 and verse 9. And then number 12, God's wise plan. All things work together for good to them that love God. Romans 8 and verse 20. And by the way, those 12 promises were found written in Our Daily Bread January 1 of 1985. In 1985, someone wrote those promises down, and then 2017, I jotted down the exact same promises and read them to you tonight, and they are no less true. November the whatever it is, was it the 4th? Is it the 5th? It's the 5th. Man, it's flying by. November 5th, 2017, than they were January 1, 1985. And they are also no less true than they were 2,000 plus years ago, that they were written down. God's promises are solid and in concrete. And if He has promised to never leave us nor forsake us, He ain't leaving, all right? He will walk with you, and He will never leave you. And you say, well, what about if I leave Him? Well, you can't leave Him. You can't leave Him. You say, yes, I can. Yes, I can. I can move. Not if you know Him as personal Lord and Savior. You can't leave Him. You can't get away from Him. I mean, He follows you everywhere you go. And just about the time you think I got away from Him, you'll turn around and you'll meet Him face to face. You will not get away from Him, not because you're not sinful enough, but because He's too full of grace to let you go. Amen. That's good news on Sunday night. I know it got dark early, but it's a good news on Sunday night. Amen? Good night. I'm not going to like this getting dark at 5 o'clock. But anyway, all men can trust the Lord. Why can we trust the Lord? Well, He tells us. He says He's unchangeable, and it's impossible for Him to lie. He goes on to say, we who have fled for refuge might find strong encouragement to seize the hope set before us. And so He says, for those of us who have fled for refuge to Christ Jesus, that we might seize the hope. What is the hope? What's the hope of every Christian? I'm heaven bound. This world's not our home. We're just passing through this place. I listened to a radio broadcast this last week, and there was a lady on there, and she was quoting from a Christian of long time ago. I used to use the phrase Christian of yesteryear, and I had a young person come and tell me, that sounds like you're an old man when you say that. No young person uses that. And so I said, well, I got to quit saying yesteryear. It does sound pretty old. I would have to agree with that. So a long time ago, all right? And the guy had said that Christians used to not look for happiness in this life because they knew that their happiness was not found in this life. They used to not look for the new home and for the new car and for the next new suit of clothes or whatever brings happiness to people nowadays. They used to not look for that type of garbage because they knew that that type of happiness was fleeting. And that once you got the new vehicle, you wanted the next new vehicle. And once you got the new home, you found out that that new home you just built, you changed 12 things about that new home that you just built if you could go back and do it over again. Because the happiness of this life is fleeting, but their hope was built in Christ and in Christ alone. And the writer here in Hebrews says, for those of us who have fled away from legalism, away from the law,